Oh, whatever, dude. Now you're messing with me. What's up, buddy? Give it up for James Buescher! Yeah! What is going on?
Have fun at your Talladega.
What is this?
Sounding bright.
You are bright.
Yeah. Bright blue shirt. Orange Bad Boy Bombers right there. Bright shoes.
Okay, I gotta ask. You're on the pole. How does that feel to be at Talladega and you're on the pole?
It's pretty awesome. Our truck, our Bad Boy Motors truck, is fast and unloaded. We didn't even work on qualifying track at all. We did one or two single car runs just to shake the truck down and make sure everything's feeling good. And it was kind of darting around a lot. We rolled real straight and the truck just kind of wanders up and down the racetrack. And we worked on it, got it better, got it to drive good, got it to draft good. It works well in draft. It does the two cars hanging well and hanging back drafting. So it was fast.
Qualifying. I'm not kidding, it was fast. It was the pole.
Yeah, we got the pole and the track cooled off a little before we went out. Engine ran a little cooler, but having that late qualifying draw was good to be able to be fast in practice and be able to walk. We probably benefited us, but the truck's fast and I think it's just a good, if not better, racetrack.
So, do you have any partners that you're going to be drafting with, or? You haven't even thought about it yet.
Well, I got my partners. Austin Dillon starts third right behind me, so we'll probably try to work together in the beginning, and hopefully we stay in packs for a while and not get the two-car team and go, two-truck team going, like the park cars are doing. The bumpers don't line up near as good in the trucks, so it could cause some serious sticky situations. We don't know what it's going to do yet. Guys tried it in practice. We tried it in practice. It felt okay, but sooner or later, somebody's gonna have a problem with it. It's not as easy as it is in the F cars. The bumpers just sit on top of each other, really. And it could make for some really bad situations.
Okay, so you got the pole. Not only does he have the pole, but you're only, what, 5 or 7 points?
7.
Okay, so I was right. 7 points out of the chase. So, not out of the chase, but out of first. Does that add anything like mentally for you, like before you start racing, or do you not even think about it and you're like, Johnny D, why'd you even bring it up?
Well, we try not to think about it. We know we have to finish the race to be able to consider being in the points battle. You never know what's going to happen at Talladega. You never know what's going to happen in the speed races. Wrecks just happen and it's near impossible to miss them. The goal is just to finish the race and ultimate goal is to win the race, but first we got to finish to be able to do that. And we thought Talladega was going to be the walk part. We were playing Las Vegas last week. Everybody was crashing the very last. So, after last week, I really don't know what's going to happen today.
Is this track more mental on a driver or more physical?
I would say mental. You have to be really aware of your surroundings. Really aware of what's going on behind you, just as much as in front of you, being able to watch in front of you, make sure that if some guys look like they're going to crash, that you have a way to make it through the back, and being able to use the draft to your advantage. Basically, you want to put your truck in a situation that's going to benefit the best, and just trying to figure out where to place your truck in a pack of trucks, or in a two-car tandem, or where to place it on a racetrack is. Where he found his feet and he was drafting. So it's a lot of fun. It's a different kind of racing than what we do every week, and I enjoy doing it.
Do you remember your first time here at Talladega? I mean, is it like that first time here, is it like white knuckles the whole time because you're at those big speeds and,
Yeah, it's pretty nerve-wracking, right out there on the racetrack for the first time in practice, and it's huge. But you're totally wide open, so it's really not that technical of a racetrack. When it's your first time, you just hold it wide open and you're on the ball around, so you don't need draft when it's your first time in the racetrack. But my first time here, so this is my second ball here, that's a good way to start here, and hopefully I can continue to be able to have success at this racetrack, and hopefully get a win here soon, hopefully today. But
not hopefully win.
Yeah, I will get a win.
There you go.
Just sure. Yeah. Hopefully today.
So I was, before I interview I don't know exactly, but you're going to be racing a Corvette tomorrow. Tell us a little bit about what you're doing tomorrow. So you're jumping from this track to going into racing a Corvette tomorrow?
I got the opportunity to go drive Porsche Racing's Corvette tomorrow in the Motor Racing Association at Daytona. So I'm leaving here to go to Daytona and run the road course.
Did you say drive online?
Yeah, it's
there is no like private plane taking you down, the dropping off right there at the speedway.
Actually, I've got some band members that live about an hour south of Daytona that came up here and watched this race, and they came from here to LA. So the race is over today, and we're going to drive around to Daytona and they're coming home.
Awesome. So I gotta ask you, what did you know as a child? What did you know that, hey, you know what? I'm gonna be a race car driver. I'm gonna be that guy. I'm gonna be that man. I'm gonna be the guy that everybody wants to be. What did you know?
I didn't start racing until I was 12 years old in Bandolero cars, but they considered that a late start. I started pretty young, but as a race can start when I'm 12 years old or 8 years old or whatever it is, but when I was like 15, we started traveling a lot and running Legends cars and winning a lot of races, and as much as I enjoy racing, I'll do it every week, we race sometimes four times a week. That's when I really knew that. That's what I wanted to do. And that was what I did to make sure I got to this level and was able to make a career out of it. So I just stayed committed, and here we are.
So I gotta ask you, have you ever just wanted to go back in time or find somebody that didn't believe in you and say, how do you like me now?
I think that's
the secret. Keep yourself around positive people.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that positive attitude and it'll work out for you.
So let me ask you then, let me back it up with this. If there's kids out there right now that want to be sitting up here where you are, and at the place that you are, what kind of advice would you give them instead of your kid?
Now, for young kids, like I said, I just stay committed to what I like doing. Whether if you like football or if you, whatever it is you like, just, if you want to do it and your heart's set on it, just stay committed and follow your dreams and work hard at it. I didn't ever, when I was in high school, I wasn't partying and stuff with all my friends on the weekends. I was at the racetrack every day. I didn't have a social life because this is what I wanted to do. And I just stay committed to doing this and follow my dreams and work hard at it. So if it's something you really want to do, just work hard at it and follow your dreams.
So in high school, did you play any sports besides racing?
I played every sport you could think of, not necessarily in high school. I played football in middle school. I played soccer, I played hockey, I played golf a little bit. But I played baseball. I guess you could say I played baseball. I started playing baseball. But I never really enjoyed any of those sports as much as I enjoyed racing. So I didn't ever try to pursue them. I tried them and I don't feel better than them and do whatever I wanted to do. So I moved on to racing.
Go get him, James!
So
get
him. So every great athlete has a great coach. In this business, who has been that coach for you? Or maybe you have a couple of them that really guided you in the right ways.
Well, I drive for Steve Turner. Steve Sandy Turner's a coach on the first course. I've driven for him since in 2005, on and off. And Mr. Turner's been really instrumental in my racing career and getting me as high as I am. In the model of the city over the years. Late model of art, and he was great at He's been kind of there for me all along the way and helped me get opportunities to drive for race cars. And he used to race himself, he's on the racetrack, he runs a race team, he understands the race cars. So he's been able to help me along the way and teach me a lot. He was the ASA for a long time, won a lot of championships in his name, so his trust is,
coach for me in years past. There's been a lot of people who have helped me. My first routine on his own actually worked with me back in 2006 in the 8-miles together and we won championship together. So there's been a lot of guys that have helped me get my start and I still work with them. Pretty cool.
So let me ask you, today you're in a truck. Tomorrow you're in a Corvette, but I'm totally different racing. And then you're in a late mile, then you're in a different car. Does it ever get confusing? Okay, what am I in today?
As far as the truck's finish line, not really. Our similar to the insides of the cars and the way that the cars react to changes, they have similar components. But for the Corvette tomorrow, I've never driven one of those. I've driven a street model Corvette, but I've never driven a Corvette race car. So it's sequential shifting, where instead of having a pattern shifter or over and through, it's all in line. You pull it back, shift up. Yeah, I've never done that.
So how did that opportunity come up? If you've never even done it before, are they just like, James, you're such an awesome driver that we want you to do this?
Well, I drove for Teddy Marsh in the K&N East Series in the 31 car back in 2007, 2008. And I've kept a relationship with them. They're great people. They're fun to work with. They're based out of Connecticut. And they run the Grand Am Series in the GT class, but they're very more set in the 31 Williams car. And that's actually a car that in the racing mod is the one they race in the Grand Am. But I've kept a relationship, and I talked to them at Watkins Glen when we were there to show Panache Mod cars, and they said they were going to Daytona this whole weekend. They raced yesterday, and they raced today, and then they raced again tomorrow. I was like, well, I can only make Sunday. I'm like, come down there and I'll put you in the car. All right, that sounds like fun. I'll be there. Thank you.
That's awesome. So what does James Buescher do when he's not racing? It sounds like you're racing all the time, but there has to be downtime. You have to, have that time that you have alone or with your friends. What do you do when you do have that downtime?
There is downtime. Lately, I had a little bit of downtime in the last 2 weeks, but before that, I was racing a lot. I leave here, like I said, I go to Daytona and race a Corvette, and then I have to go to Charlotte where our teams are, and we're testing in Rockingham on Tuesday, and then we go to Martinsville Thursday. So we're really busy right now, but when I'm home in the spare time, I call for a little bit, I'll spend some time with your family, and I'll say, spend time around the house, and basically do housework, go along with my bad boy motor, and just hang out the house.
So, this year's not even done, but I have to ask you, what are your goals in the next couple of years?
The next couple of years, I'd like to be able to say next year, that was 2011 Truck Series Championship.
There you go.
Hopefully we can win the championship this year. That'd be the primary goal in the near future. But over the next few years, I'd like to be able to go up to the national level on a full-time basis and maybe go to compete for the championship there and win some races and then ultimately make it to the cup level and be able to compete for championships and first match and stuff on the cup level.
Awesome. Now, I asked you about coaches. Okay, and you answered that question. That was a great answer. But I have to ask you, who are your heroes in this sport? When you were a kid watching NASCAR, who were your heroes? Who did you watch and say, one of these days I'm going to be just like him?
Well, I never said I just want to be just like one guy. People ask me who I base my driving style off of, or what model myself after being a race car driver, how I act off the track, how I act on the track. And I just try to pull off of each driver. We watch them all. There's not one guy that I've ever studied that was my only guy I want to be like. But I was Rusty Wallace fan when I was younger. I was Jeff Gordon fan. Dale Earnhardt. You watch them all. The guys that do great at the sport, you want to be like them. Thinking back and saying I watched racing when I was 2 years old, watching Dick Gordon, Russell Wallace, all those guys on TV, and over the last couple of years, starting to meet these guys and race against them, it's pretty cool to be able to look back at how far I came since I started a racing career, and they're still here to be able to race against them. That's pretty cool.
Okay, one last question. I know that you have a couple minutes and you can sign some autographs, I was told. Is that cool?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, cool. So, do you remember the first time that you had to give an autograph? And what that feeling was like, or the first time you had to do an interview and the cameras are, you know, right in your face, or you had to do an interview like this, and do you still get nervous when you have to do like the PR part of it and not just the racing part of it?
I remember the first time I had to do like a TV interview, I was really nervous, stuttered a lot, and just couldn't do my words to come out, but you know, it's kind of nerve wracking the first time you put the camera in your face. You can say that you're not going to be nervous, but the first time I have, it's like, wow, this is something I've never done before. But now I've been doing it for a while, you know, and doing stuff like this and doing TV interviews and talking in public. I used to not have to talk up on stage, talk in public at all, but that really bothered me.
So does your family, friends, and your fiance, do they treat you any different back home, or do you go home and you're like, I'm not doing the yard work, I'm James Buescher. And she's like, listen, you're flipping James right now and you cut the grass because I said so.
No, I'm just a normal person. I mow my grass, I clean my house, I take the trash out. I mean, I don't get treated any different for being a race car driver. It's just my job, and I want to go home and fix things if I work in an office every week.
But you don't. But you're an awesome race car driver. Yeah, that's right. And you're going to win today. That's right. James, thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Let's give it up for James Buescher.